It is my honor to present our next speaker. She's just finished her second book with us. We're so excited about this. I mean, these are two fantastic books. You've got to get them. I will let, because I know that's a big part of your talk, is what they're about, so I won't
you
do
took
that.
Enough yesterday.
Yes, I won't do that. So we'll let you do that. But you must know, in the second book, the first one's Windows of Opportunity, and it came out just a little over a
year. 2009.
And then this one came out this week. So it just got here. And it's got a wonderful meditation CD in the back of Arcturian meditations and energy meditations. Fantastic. Yes. Yes. Wonderful. And it's called Raising Our Vibrations for the New Age. Wonderful, wonderful stuff. So I want Sherry to take it over so you can get the full impact of everything that she has to say. So you're welcome.
Thank you so much.
Sherry Cortland.
Hi, everybody. So, for over 30 years now, I have been on a search for the truth about who we are and why we're here. Everybody in this room is on the same search, right? Absolutely. Well, I've read a lot of books. I have channeled a lot of stuff from guide groups. I have attended a lot of workshops. And there are two things that I've really learned from all of these years of searching. First is that we're evolving. We're evolving. And secondly is that we're all connected. We're intricately connected. We are not on this journey alone. And Julia, anyone who saw Julia yesterday, saw the beautiful illustration she did of just how we're connected. And I have to tell you, too, that there's really no doubt in my mind that it's synchronicity in action when we come together in groups like this one accidentally, right, to learn and to grow and to share our discoveries with each other. Fellow lightworkers, I am just so honored to be here with you today. Thank you so much for being here. I channel spirit through automatic writing. How many of you have heard of automatic writing? You know what it is. Everybody knows what it is. Okay, good. Well, after years and years of reading just everything and anything that I could get my hands on metaphysically, I decided that I wanted more than just a good read. I wanted to be like Ruth Montgomery, Edgar Cayce, Shirley MacLaine, Dolores Cannon, and all of the others who were able to connect directly with spirit. And so what I did was I started to take some psychic development classes. And I hope that they would help me learn to connect directly with spirit. Looking back on it now, I'm pretty sure that the reason that I was just so dedicated to doing this was because there were books that were waiting to be written. But I had no idea about those books back then. I just wanted to connect. And so during my first psychic development course, I learned about the different ways that spirit communicates with us. And one night the teacher announced, well, tonight we're going to do automatic writing. Well, I have been trying to do automatic writing for several months at home, and I really had nothing to show for it except a cramped hand because I was holding onto the pen too tight. And so, with my very big mouth, I loudly said in class, I will never be able to do that. Never be able to do that. Well, as those words were coming out of my mouth, the energy started to come into my hand, and I drew some of the most beautiful circles that you will ever see in your entire life. Well, you know, with a little time and practice, the scribbles turned into words, and then eventually two books were channeled through me with automatic writing, and I'm working on a third one right now. Now, I started doing automatic writing, it was back in the 80s, and still today, I have to tell you, it is my favorite way to connect with spirit. I love the back and forth conversation that it allows us to have with our guides and with our angels. And what I really love about it is that it's a written record. It's a written record that we can read and reread whenever we want to. You know, there's no straining the brain to try and remember what was said, which was really great when I was in my 30s, and I gotta tell you, much better now that I'm in my 50s. It's a good thing. Now, I was so excited when I first started to work with my guide groups, and I would ask them to write with me every single chance that I got. I mean, it didn't matter where I was, at home, in the car, online at the bank, I'm going to even tell you probably in the bathroom, I don't know, any place. I was just so excited. I could not wait to see what they would say next, and I was happy to be making contact. Now, back in the 80s and the 90s, I used plain old pen and paper to do automatic writing, and that worked great, except for when I ran out of space on whatever happened to be handy to write on, you know? So I have used the backs of business cards, envelopes, utility bills, napkins. I once even wrote on the inside of my hand, right? I had no paper, I was desperate. Pretty sure that's when I finally smartened up, started carrying a notebook with me. And then in 2004, and I have no idea why I waited so long, I switched over to the computer. Love the computer with automatic writing. It makes it so much easier, especially when it comes to sorting material by subject for future reference. Now, I switched over to the computer right around the time that Spirit started dictating material for my first book, Windows of Opportunity. Now, I'll never forget the day that Jeremy, who is my main guide for this incarnation, told me that it was time to write a book. I cracked up laughing. It was the most ridiculous thing that I ever heard. Write a book? I don't want to write a book. And I thought he was just off of his rocker, just completely off of his rocker. Well, I didn't want to do it, and I'll tell you why. I was very happy in my little New Age closet. I did not want to come out of it. I wanted to stay put, right? But Jeremy did not give up about this book stuff until I gave in. And that's when I learned a very important lesson, which I'm sure you all know. You cannot argue with Spirit. Am I right? Yeah, you just can't. You cannot win an argument. So to write Windows of Opportunity, I worked with a guide group that I call the GG. What an imagination I have, right? Guide group GG. Well, this group included Jeremy and several other guides and entities, and then three of my family members who are presently on the other side of the veil. Now, I told you that I was dragging my feet about starting this book. I did not want to do it. Wanted to stay in that closet. So what Jeremy did to keep me properly motivated and on time for the book sessions, he put my grandmother in charge. He made her spokesguide for this project because he knew, doesn't matter, I'm going to obey her no matter where she is, what side of the veil she's on. Brilliant move on his part. Got me going, got me working. So anyway, via automatic writing, I worked with the GG, really what seemed to me to be just an impossible task to write this book. And then in mid-2008, I got a call from Dolores Cannon. She said she wanted to publish the book. I was blown away. I was really surprised because I truly thought that I was just humoring the GG by sending out that manuscript to Ozark Mountain Publishing. I never thought it would get published. Never thought I'd have to come out of the closet. Well, I was wrong. Once the book came out, I suddenly found myself very much out of that closet. I started doing tons and tons of radio interviews, which is something you've got to do when you're an author, and I began teaching some spiritual acceleration workshops that were based on some of the tools that are in Windows of Opportunity. So thanks to that first book, I have had the honor of meeting and learning from so many kindred souls. You know, folks just like you and me who share our quest and our thirst for knowledge and also the yearning to find out the truth of our existence. And I'm very happy to report to you that many of the people that I've met over the last 18 months, they're not only actively seeking to learn and understand why we experience the things that we do, but they're also very much ready to accept responsibility for their own learning and growth. Now, I don't know about you guys, but to me, this just screams evolution to me. So that brings me to my new book now, Raising Our Vibrations for the New Age, which is about the evolution of the human race. According to the guide groups who dictated the material for the Vibrations book, we are on the final leg of an unprecedented evolutionary journey. And the good news is that we're close to completing our overall mission, which is the transition of the human race, simultaneously with the planet Earth from a third dimensional level of existence to the higher vibrational level of the fifth dimension. No surprise to anybody here, am I right? Okay, good. We're all on the same page, literally. It's great news, I think, to know from the guide groups that we're getting close. But, my guide groups are very clear that it is not quite time yet for us to relax into our lazy boy recliners. Not yet. We have work to do. And a little later, I'm going to share some channeled suggestions on how we can make some progress faster. But first, I'd like to share with you where the information in the Vibrations book originated and where the five steps to higher vibrations that we're going to talk about came from. Now, when Jeremy told me that it was time to write a second book, I just assumed that I would continue on with the GG and report to my grandmother again. That's what I figured would happen, but that's not the way that it was. For Vibrations, I got a new guide group. Gilbert and the group were the new spokes guide and the new group that worked on the Vibrations project. They provided much of the information for that new book. And then, just as I was about to start sorting the information from Gilbert and his group into chapters, figuring that I was done, another entity joined the project. So Aknanda introduced himself to me one day in July 2010 as I was sitting under a big oak tree in my front yard and I was meditating. Now, when I say he introduced me, I don't want you to think that he walked up and plopped down in the chair next to me. This was in my head, right? Although, who knows, maybe he did plop down in the chair next to me, I don't know, could be. Now, as Aknanda started talking, I reached for my notebook, because I don't write on my hand anymore, now I do carry a notebook. As I listened in amazement, I was just so amazed at the clarification of who was speaking to me. Aknanda explained that he's from Arcturus, and that Aknanda and the Arcturians would also work with me on the Vibrations book. So they added information about our galactic heritage, and they also provided two Arcturian meditation exercises designed to help us attract and hold the light, raise our vibrations, and also to help us expedite our spiritual growth. Now, they also explained to me just what the light is that we're drawing and holding. And you know, I gotta tell you, in all of these years of studying and reading and hearing, you've got to hold the light, you've got to attract and hold the light, I always wondered, what light is this? What light is this? But I never asked the question. And I think one thing that we've heard over and over the last couple of days is what? You got to ask, right? And I never did. Well, until now. And so Aknanda told me where this light comes from. He explained that our sun is a source of third dimensional light, and we have plenty of that here already. We don't need any more third dimensional light. We're full. The light that we want to attract and hold is fifth dimensional light, and that light comes from a source called the Great Central Sun. The Great Central Sun. I see some people nodding, so some of you already know about this. According to Aknanda, the Great Central Sun is located at the center of the Milky Way galaxy, and the Great Central Sun is the spiritual center of our galaxy. So as such, the Great Central Sun is the source of fifth dimensional energy and high vibration, fifth dimension light for our galaxy, for the Milky Way. And that makes the Great Central Sun the source of the light that lightworkers are and have been attracting and holding for generations. And we hold this light, why? We hold it for the express purpose of assisting the transition of human beings and the Earth to a fifth dimensional state of being. That's our job. Now, Gilbert and Aknanda have channeled a lot about human evolution, and most particularly, they wrote about how we can take control of our own progress, how we can raise our own vibrational levels. And of course, that's what I'm here to talk about today. I'm so happy to be here to share with you five of the many simple yet very, very powerful ways that we can really just take the bull by the horns and make a difference for ourselves, for each other, and for our entire planet. Now, I know that these five steps are what you guys are here to hear. That's what you're in this room for, and I promise you, I'm getting very close to giving you that list, but I have just a little bit more that I want to talk about why it's so important that we raise our vibrations, and I can't believe that I put this in my notes, and then I will get to the tofu and potatoes of my talk. That's a little vegetarian humor, very little, I know. Okay. Raising our vibrations, guys, raising our vibrations is so important, because as we raise those vibrations, we are playing an active role, in the shifting of our individual and collective energies to a fifth dimensional consciousness. And as we actively shift our consciousness, we evolve. We evolve personally, we evolve as a species, and our planet evolves too. Now, the shift that we hear so much talk about, the shift that advertisers, movie makers, the media, they've all christened it what? 2012, right? This is actually a shift in consciousness for the human race and for planet Earth. So, who's behind this shift? Who is behind this shift? It is not the advertisers who are trying to scare the pants off us so that we buy their products. They're not behind the shift. I'm going to show you right now exactly who's behind this shift. Are you ready? You ready to see? Here's the big reveal. Okay, look around. Look to your left, look to your right, look behind you, look in front of you, and most especially if you've got a mirror handy, take a good look in that mirror, okay? You're the guilty parties. I'm the guilty party. It's us. We are all behind this shift because the human race is connected. We are all connected, and we are responsible for our own evolution, period. It's us. Now, we're behind this shift, and lightworkers are at the forefront of this movement. Lightworkers are the leaders in the current evolutionary journey of human beings. And each one of us in this room, we have a dual role to play. It's not easy for us light workers. As human beings, we have to deal with the day-to-day activities, the challenges, the drama of life, the pain, the tragedies, all the stuff that happens to us on a daily basis just from being alive. But then as light workers, we have three additional responsibilities, right? Our load is heavy. We have to attract and hold the light. We have to create positive energy to facilitate this ongoing shift in consciousness. And thirdly, we need to stem the flow of negative energy. This is a lot of work, don't you think? Yeah. Well, the better we do our jobs, the easier we're all going to get through this shift. But for a light worker, being stationed on planet Earth, it's a lot like being in a galactic witness protection program, don't you think? Nobody knows who you are. We don't even know who we are, right? We have been undercover. And many of us, including myself, have in the past or are currently living in fear about talking about what we believe, who we are, and what the heck we're here to do. You know, heck, a lot of us didn't even know what we were here to do until very recently, and some of us are so deep undercover that they're just starting to wake up right now. You know, the human race has been sleepwalking for a very long time, but, we are waking up a little faster, and we are remembering a little more with each subsequent incarnation that we experience. And with each succeeding incarnation, we have learned more and more to trust that this little voice within, this herald of our higher selves, is indeed leading us toward our ultimate collective goal, which again is to bring about the evolution of the human race to another level of existence. That's the whole point here. Big project, huh? Big project. And you know, we have long been part of this monumental project of galactic proportions. And the word teamwork, it really just isn't big enough, I don't think, to describe what we're part of. And I also don't think that it aptly describes the way that we've been working blind and undercover for generations and generations without a clear picture of our end game. Sure, when we're on the other side of the veil and we're planning, we know what we're going to do, we know why, but once we get here, we forget and we don't know. We have no clear end picture. But you know what? We've done well. Jeremy, Gilbert, Aknanda, they have all communicated that we're making progress. Even though sometimes it seems like we're going backwards instead of forward, we are making progress. In fact, all three of my guide groups agree, and they maintain, that while the timing of the completion of the shift, nobody knows when that's going to be. Nobody has any idea quite when that's going to be. But they all say that our goal is firmly within reach. And when enough of us achieve, whatever that predetermined frequency is, I don't know what it is, Guy might know better than me, I have no idea what it is, the human race, along with the planet Earth, will take a history-making step up the evolutionary ladder. Now, this is why, guys, it is so important for us to take charge and make a concerted and connected effort to raise our vibrations. So how can we help ourselves along? What can we do here? Well, it really comes back to the three things that I mentioned earlier. We have to continue to attract the fifth dimensional light to our planet. We have to create as much positive energy as we possibly can. And we need to decrease our daily output of negative energy. Sounds simple, yes? Simple in theory, maybe, but it is hard work. This is very hard work, which is why I might add that we are called light workers and not light loafers, right? Okay. So, the work that we have left to do, I have bad news for you. The work we have left to do is not physical labor. I have to tell you, I wish it was, because it would be so much easier for us to just grab our shovels, head out, dig X number of ditches apiece, and be done with it. But it's not that easy. The work that we have to do is far more difficult. Why? Because it's work that we have to do on ourselves. We need to make some behavior and attitude adjustments. And as we make them, we will find ourselves holding more light, creating tons of positive energy, and significantly decreasing the amount of negative energy that we are spewing out into the atmosphere. All right? So, this brings me finally, I'm sure you're glad to know this, finally to the five steps to higher vibrations. Are you guys ready? Okay. Let's get to them. Step number one, I don't think this is going to be a surprise to anyone in this room. Step number one is watch what you think, watch what you say, and watch what you do at this very important time in history. Watch what you think, watch what you say, and watch what you do at this very important time in history. Let me start with some words from Gilbert about this very crucial first step. Gilbert says, "The more positive energy that is put out there, the better off all will be. It is very important for all to start to monitor their thoughts because thoughts are extremely powerful things. There is nothing that exists that wasn't first a thought. Nothing that has happened that wasn't first a thought. Things manifest more slowly on the planet Earth than in other places, but they still manifest. As many will see, thoughts are becoming things at a much faster rate, and all must watch their thoughts and words. We cannot emphasize this to you enough. Continue to pay great attention to your thoughts and to your words. They will manifest quickly, and they can do great good, just as they can do damage or harm. Getting your thoughts and words under control will help you raise your vibrational level." Okay. Anybody here ever read Parade magazine? Ever see that on Sunday? It's like a little supplement to the Sunday paper. All right. Well, about 6 months ago, there was an article in Parade that caught my eye. It was about a woman named Cynthia Stafford. Anybody ever heard of her? She won $112 million in the lottery. $112 million. And she says, insists, believes that she did this by focusing on winning that exact amount for 4 months. She slept with this number under her pillow. I know you're all thinking, I'm gonna do this tonight, right? She slept with this number under her pillow. She even visualized exactly how she was gonna react when she got up on that fateful Sunday morning and saw her winning numbers there in the paper, right? I mean, she had this worked out in her head. And then after four months, she figured it was out there and in the flow of energy, and she just kind of, you know, relaxed into it, knowing and trusting that this was gonna happen. And you know what? It did. It happened. She won $112 million. I mean, how cool is that? Well, I read a separate article where Stafford said that the first 2 weeks of focusing on this goal, of focusing on this $112 million windfall, she said that it took a tremendous amount of discipline. In fact, she said that it was absolutely exhausting for her to focus on this. And my point here, the reason why I'm bringing up this lottery winner, is that if focusing on something so fun and so cool, like winning the lottery, is that exhausting for a human being, how much effort and discipline do you think it's going to take for us to get control of our thoughts and our words on a daily basis? It's work, yes? It's work. But the good news is that it does get easier with time. It gets easier as we go along. But it's still work, and it still needs to be done, which is why watching what we think, what we say, and what we do are the number one item on Gilbert's list. And you know what? I got to tell you, this instruction from Gilbert, it's really not new. This is not news. And before we go on to the next step, I want to share with you some lines from the sayings of Buddha that I think you're going to find very interesting. Buddha said, "We are what we think. All that we are arises with our thoughts. With our thoughts, we make the world. Speak or act with an impure mind, and trouble will follow you as the wheel follows the ox that draws the cart." We are what we think. All that we are arises with our thoughts. With our thoughts, we make the world. Speak or act with a pure mind, and happiness will follow you as your shadow, unshakable. So, fellow lightworkers, if you don't know it already, I'm going to tell you, we are already excellent, excellent manifestors subconsciously. So just imagine, think about this, what we can do on a conscious level as we start putting our attention firmly and with focus on watching our thoughts, our words, and our actions. Think of the evolutionary progress that we're going to make together. Step number two is stop judging other people. Stop judging other people. Gilbert says that when we spend time judging each other, we become like mini power plants, just spewing negative energy out into the atmosphere. He wants me to remind everybody, and I know that you know this, this is just a reminder, that when we're on the other side of the veil and we're planning for our upcoming incarnation, when we're there, we understand the why behind the experiences that we're going to have when we get back over here, yes? Because why? We plan them, right? We know what's going to happen. We know these experiences and lessons and karmic debt. But when we get back here to this side of the veil, we don't remember. We don't remember the what's and whys of our own life plan, so we certainly don't know the what's and whys of somebody else's life plan. And so we're in no position then to stand in judgment. We also don't know what's going on in someone else's life at any given moment in time. For example, let's say we're at the grocery store and we're confronted with a cashier who just really is coming across as unfriendly. We've all been there, right? It's possible, just possible, that this person isn't herself that day. Maybe she had a sick child, got no sleep the night before, but maybe she lost a loved one, maybe she ran out of gas on the way to work, maybe she had an accident on the way to work. Who knows? Who knows? We don't know, and that's the point. But what we do know is this. When we are confronted with a situation like this, we have a choice. We have a choice. We can immediately judge that person. We can call her unkind names in our head or even out loud. And if we do that, then we do what? We spew negative energy, yes? Or we can do our best to stay positive in this situation, challenging situation. And even though we got service that we perceived as less than friendly, but then what are we doing? We're negating the negative energy, and we're also creating positive energy, which helps our vibrations. Now, this step number two, this admonition from Gilbert to stop judging others, this is really all about decreasing our output of negative energy. And as we spend less time judging others, we will naturally diminish the amount of negative energy that we produce. The objective of step number two here is for positive energy to eventually outweigh the negative on our planet. We want positive to outweigh the negative, right? And by taking steps to reduce our output of negative energy, that's going to help us achieve this goal. Now, in the long run, putting the brakes on being judgmental will help us reach our end goal faster. But in the short run, we're not going to get all worked up and ruin our day or even our week over small slights that might be real or might be imagined, right? And we'll also be happier. We will be happier. So that is step number two. Step number three, be positive in the face of adversity. Be positive in the face of adversity. Let me start with a quote from Gilbert. When adverse circumstances present themselves or something occurs that causes grief, examine them for windows of opportunity and relationship villains. Try to understand that overcoming adversity is part of the overall life plan of many individuals. I'm going to read that last sentence again from Gilbert. Try to understand that overcoming adversity is part of the overall life plan for many individuals, meaning that we planned this adversity for ourselves, right? In my book, Windows of Opportunity, the original GG, they introduced the concepts of windows of opportunity and relationship villains. They're basically tools that we've incorporated into our lives for the express purpose of expediting our spiritual growth. Now, to help us better understand why Gilbert is very concerned about us understanding that overcoming adversity is part of our overall life plan, I'm going to take just a moment and talk about these two concepts. Let me start with relationship villains. Relationship villains, guys, are entities who are our closest universal friends when we're on the other side of the veil. But for this incarnation, they have volunteered to play the role of the bad guy. They've put on the black hat. This is the part that they're going to play in our lives, right? And they do this in order to help us cross things off of our spiritual must-learn list. And in our current lives, in our current incarnations, relationship villains, they could be people who merely annoy us, all the way up to people that we might consider to be our so-called enemies, and everywhere in between, right? Okay. They create and co-create unpleasant situations that open windows of opportunity for us to learn and grow. They do this because their purpose, the purpose of a relationship villain, is to help us meet our goals for learning and growth. That's what these lifetimes are all about. Now, so how do you spot a relationship villain? Well, relationship villains can be anywhere. They can be anybody. To start with, I'm going to say, think romantic relationships. Does that make sense to anybody? That's a good place to start. Look at your romantic relationships. No surprise there. Think about your friends. They can sometimes be relationship villains. People you work with. You know, even somebody who's rude to you at the post office could be opening up a nice window of opportunity for you to learn a lesson. Ah, and I should tell you this too. You should be aware of this. We don't just have relationship villains. We are relationship villains for other people too. Just a little something to keep in mind there. Now let's talk about windows of opportunity. Windows are opportunities for growth and learning that we personally created for ourselves. Again, we did this while we're on the other side of the veil. Think of your life like a book with chapters, right? A book with chapters. And we insert scenarios or situations that we've constructed and we've engineered to help us learn a particular lesson or to have a growth experience that our souls very much want to have. So why bother to look for windows of opportunity? Sounds like more work, right? Well, each time that we learn a lesson or we complete an experience, we go through a metaphorical window. There's not really a window. This is metaphorical. And the faster we spot and go through a window, the more time we have to work on the other items on our must-learn or must-do list for this lifetime. And in fact, in order to help us make sure that we learn what we want to learn and get the experiences that we want to learn, we will create many, many, many windows of opportunity for the very same lesson or experience. That way, if we miss one, it's okay. There's going to be another one. We're going to learn this lesson. The only drawback to this is that if you don't learn on the ground floor, as Jeremy says, and you go all the way up to the penthouse, you're going to have a lot of drama going on, a lot of pain and drama. So the reason that we want to look for these windows of opportunity is because if we find them early, we can save ourselves a lot of pain and drama. And in fact, a series of windows that we missed windows of opportunity, that's really what we refer to as a life script. You've all heard that term, right? Okay. All right, so the reason why we make them more dramatic as we're going up to the penthouse is because we're really effectively kind of shaking ourselves and kind of slapping ourselves awake so that we will finally, eventually learn this lesson that we so very much want to learn. So learning to spot these windows early will save ourselves drama, will save ourselves pain, and we'll become proactive instead of reactive, and that's very important. Spotting windows, and taking the action to learn the lesson, this is something that is going to help us expedite our spiritual growth. Now, Gilbert's point with step number three here is that if we can kind of wake up a little bit, open our eyes enough to start to recognize the windows and the villains in our lives, then we can identify and acknowledge our life scripts. And once we do that, we'll stop repeating the same old negative patterns of behavior that we're used to, and we'll make the appropriate course changes that we need to make, and we'll take control of our progress. And a lovely little side effect to understanding windows is a decrease in the amount of negative energy that we put out into the atmosphere, that we expel into the atmosphere. How does that happen? Well, as we recognize a growth opportunity, we'll stop lamenting our circumstances, we'll stop cursing out other people for the stuff that we think they're responsible for, all the crappy things that happen in our lives. Instead of placing blame and living on poor me avenue, we will be free to take control and look for ways to change our behavior and take action. And taking action, you already know this, taking action is what propels us forward, right? That's what helps us evolve. So becoming accomplished at being positive in the face of adversity, which is much easier to say than do, yes, has dual benefits when it comes to increasing our vibrations. By being positive, we increase our positive energy output. And by examining our lives and our circumstances and taking positive action instead of complaining, we will churn out less negative energy. So being positive in the face of adversity is really all about taking charge of our spiritual growth. And that is something that every single one of us in this room has the power to do. Do you guys agree with me?
Yes.
Good. Step number four. Okay. You might not like this one. Look for ways to bring more light to the planet. Look for ways to bring more light to the planet. Now, this is something that we can do in baby steps with Sasquatch size footprints, okay? Little baby steps, big results. Now, I've got a sub list here from Gilbert on how we can do this. Just a couple of examples of the things that will help us attract and hold the light while at the same time having an immediate, a powerful, and a positive vibrational impact on those around us, ourselves, and our planet. First up, stop gossiping. Gilbert says, stop gossiping. It's not good for anyone. Next, he says, stop being rude. Stop being rude. It spews negativity into the atmosphere. Next, stop looking for underlying insults in what other people say to you. Stop looking for underlying insults, something that doesn't really exist, in what people are saying to you, and stop insulting other people. Gilbert says, all are on their individual path, and you don't know what it is. Just because others may not meet your current standards does not make them wrong. Next up on his sublist, start looking for ways to be nice to people. Look for ways to be nice to people, including, but not limited to, greeting people in a friendly way, saying good morning, good afternoon, good evening, hello, just anything like that. Say nice things when appropriate. Gilbert says if you can say something nice to someone in a sincere way, then do it. Look for things that you admire about others and give them a compliment. Both the person saying it and the person receiving the kind words will benefit with a burst of positive energy. Next up, hold the door for someone when they need it. Hold the door for someone when they need it. Gilbert says this carries a big positive energy bang. What a simple thing to do, right? Hold the door. And then, lastly, give someone else the parking spot. Now, I'm laughing here because I'm going to talk about this in a couple of minutes. Give someone else the parking spot when two of you are trying to get it at the same time. None of us really want to do that, right? Now, there are lots and lots of other suggestions, so many from Gilbert in the book about how to attract the light. But interestingly, very interestingly to me, they all come back to the same thing, to one thing, the golden rule. Treat other people and our planet the way that you want to be treated, and you'll not only increase your own vibrational level, you're going to have a huge positive impact on those around you and on our planet, which is going to help us all evolve that much faster. All right, on to step number 5. I have saved the easiest step for last. Step number 5 is smile. Smile. That's it. That's all you got to do. Smile. Yet as simple and easy as this is, a smile has a huge, huge impact when it comes to increasing our output of positive energy. How so? Because smiles are catching. They are catching. When you smile at someone, they cannot help but smile back at you. It's just the way that it is. And you know what? We can, each one of us, each and every one of us, become metaphysical Johnny Appleseeds, right? And spread positive energy all over via smiles on a daily basis. That's all we have to do is smile. Here's a little something from Gilbert about smiling. Smile at everyone you see. Not a crazy person smile, Sherry, but a nice smile. Or he knows me, what can I say? But a nice smile or even a half smile will help as long as it is genuine. Smiling perks people up, and both the one who is doing the smiling and the one who is smiled at will feel positive energy from this simple yet powerful act. We know that we've talked about this before, but if you think about it, you will realize that the smallest smile yields big results. When you smile at someone, they cannot help but smile back. And when they do, they release endorphins in their body. They become happier, even if it's just for a little bit. It's enough to decrease negativity within that person and for the planet. Not only are the original smiler and smiley affected, but everyone they come into contact with that day will feel better and benefit from their positive vibrations. With no effort, they will share in it, adding their own positive energies to the atmosphere and sharing them with those around them. A smile is a small thing, but it has a very big charge to it, and if everyone will start smiling more, they will help raise their vibrational level while helping others and the planet at the same time. So, the bottom line on smiling. Well, it makes us feel good, no doubt about that. It pumps up the positive vibrations, and it has a ripple effect. So, metaphysically speaking, smiling really packs just a huge vibrational punch for us. And smiling is number 5, so there we have it. Those are the 5 steps to higher vibrations that will help us co-create a smoother evolution for ourselves. But now that we've got the list, what are we going to do? What are we going to do with it? How are we going to get started? There's a lot of stuff packed into this little 5-step list, don't you think? There's a lot to do here. Well, personally, speaking for myself, I like what the lottery winner did. She put all her focus on one thing for 4 months. And as she said, it was hard to focus at first. It took practice, but then it became a habit for her to picture herself winning all that money. So I think starting with one thing and mastering it is a great way to create new habits and make progress. And so that's the route that I took when I got started on these steps about a year ago. Now, pretty quickly, when this list was dictated, it didn't take long for me to realize I had a lot of work that I had to do on myself, okay? No easy list here for me. So what I did was I sat down, I drew up a little action plan, and I don't know if it's because I'm lazy or because I just like to see progress faster, but I chose the easiest thing to do first. The thing that I felt would be easiest for me was top of my list. And then the second easiest thing and the third easiest thing, all the way down until whatever I felt was the hardest for me. So that's the way that I got started. Now, in the interest of full disclosure, let me say that creating good habits like this and changing habits, again, it's work, but we are light workers. It takes time, it takes effort, but I am making a little bit of progress. You'll make progress too, but you got to get started someplace, right? So anybody have any idea what step I started with first? What do you think I started with first? Smiling. I knew you guys were going to know that. Absolutely, I started with smiling. And here's what happened when I started my adventures in smiling. Well, I found out that it's very easy for me. They were adventures. I found out that it's very easy for me to smile at people that I don't know. I thought that was going to be hard, but it wasn't. And oh my gosh, wait until you guys start to do this. Wait till you start to do this and you see the looks on people's faces. You know, they really do smile back. Now, sometimes it looks like they don't want to smile back at you, right? And sometimes they just get these confused look on their faces, but that just makes me smile all the bigger. I love it. I love it. Well, I have been smiling at strangers for a good year now. I have yet to smile at someone who has not returned that smile. In fact, I have now expanded my adventures in smiling to include anyone walking past me when I'm going into a building or a store, everyone in the hallways at work, everyone who walks into my office, anyone who approaches me anywhere, and now I even smile on the telephone when I'm talking on the phone. I think it makes my voice sound friendlier. Maybe it does, maybe it doesn't, but another thing that I've started to do too, now when I walk into a room, the first thing that I do is look around, I make eye contact with everybody there, I smile and I say hello. And it's contagious, it really is. People do smile back. And you know what else? I feel happier. Gilbert's right. Being nice does make you happier. It's true. Now, the second thing that I tackled was the parking lot advice. So here we are. All right. Giving up a parking spot, not a problem for me, because I got to tell you, I don't care where I park. I want to park, get into the store, get out, get home. I don't care about where that spot is. But my husband, Ted, my best friend, Heidi, they must have the closest spot possible. They will circle 5 times, 6 times, 10 times. You know people like this? You know what I'm talking about? Okay. All right. And then they park, and what happens? A car that's closer moves, and what do they want to do? Move over to that other spot. This drives me bananas, absolutely bananas. So I used to make smart alecky remarks to them, of course, when they were doing this. But now, thanks to Gilbert's advice, I try very hard to just chill out, enjoy the ride, keep my big mouth shut. Now, I realized that by keeping my big mouth shut, I can simultaneously work on watch what you say and don't be rude at the very same time. Kind of like a buy one, get one free sale, a new age BOGO, right? A new age BOGO. So I have to admit to you, though, that when I first tried to keep my mouth shut about their parking habits, I was biting my tongue, just literally biting my tongue. It wasn't easy for me to do this. It did get easier as time went on, but I'll tell you this, what an epiphany for me to realize how much negative energy I had been spewing out into the atmosphere with my snarky little parking comments. Just so much. So anyway, I made some progress there. What's next for me on this one? Because I have not fully tackled this yet. Well, someday I am hoping to put some positive energy into these situations by saying the words, "nice parking spot," without any sarcasm at all in my voice. Now, I cannot even say it to you without sarcasm in my voice, yes? All right, so you know that I have a lot of work left to do on this. Greeting people is something that really happened naturally for me. It went hand in hand with my adventures in smiling. They pretty much go together, you know? So that one was easy to add into the mix. I really think that was another BOGO. Holding the door open for people. That's another thing that I tried. It was close to the top of my list. I gotta tell you, men, I love the looks on your faces when I hold the door open for you. Any other women ever held the door open for a man? Yes? Okay. They don't want to go through, do they? They just don't want to go through. So I smile, I laugh, I say, "It's 2011, go, go." And they start to laugh and they smile. These things really, really do work. And you know, another thing that I've been working on over the past year is finding something nice to say to people that I don't know. Now, Gilbert says that it has to be genuine. It has to be genuine or it's counterproductive to creating positive energy and holding the light and sharing the light. But I have found, though, that it's surprisingly easy to find something nice to say to people. And here's my secret. You want my secret? All right. Well, unless you are living in or visiting a nudist colony, everyone you see has clothes on, am I right? Okay, so then it's very easy to say there's tons of options. Nice shirt, slack, skirt, pocketbook, eyeglasses, hair. There's something that you can find on almost everyone that you admire or you like, right? So that's my little secret in that one. Now, let me share with you how I absolutely, positively, beyond a shadow of a doubt, know that this stuff works. Someone stopped me in the hall at work, and they told me that I have beautiful eyes. Oh, yes, I have beautiful eyes. Well, I got to tell you guys, I was just on cloud nine for the rest of the day. I wasn't expecting that. I was on cloud nine. I was so happy. And don't think I don't know that my guides staged that little interaction just to prove their point. I know that they did that, but you know what? Didn't matter. Didn't matter. I felt great after getting that unsolicited compliment, ran home and told my husband all about my beautiful eyes, and I wanted to make other people feel great too. It's just so catching. Oh, I just turned the page. Okay. Guys, I have a homework assignment for you. Not me. I don't have the homework assignment for you. Gilbert and the group have a homework assignment for you. Are you ready? All right. Your homework assignment is to meditate on the list that I just gave you and form your own action plan. Now, if you didn't write the stuff down, that's okay. Don't worry about it. Got it right here for you, all typed out. Gilbert is nothing if not efficient. So I will put these out for you after. Now, my suggestion is this, just based on my last year of doing this, concentrate on the stuff that's the easiest for you to do. The stuff that's easiest to do first, save the more challenging stuff for later, because as you do the easy stuff, you'll be chipping away at the harder stuff at the same time. And also, you're not alone in this homework assignment. You have a coach. Coach Gilbert will be at your side, and in fact, he has some words right now to cheer you on. Here's what Coach Gilbert says. Here's what happens when you put these things into practice and they become habit. You will change. You will become a nicer person. Your vibrational level will rise. You will find more opportunities for growth. People will want to be around you more because they will sense the light within you. You will be helping the planet complete the shift in an easier manner, and you will be taking steps toward becoming a fifth dimensional being. Now, I'm pretty sure, don't have a clock in front of me, but I'm pretty sure that my time is running out and I've got to wrap up. But I do want to share just one more tidbit, if you'll bear with me, on the subject of evolution from Gilbert and the group. Gilbert says, there are those who will scoff at the information now coming through to many channels on your side of the veil, but the fact of the matter is that evolution is taking place. We've spoken about evolution in the past, and when we did not realize how close at hand the next step in human evolution would be. That is how quickly things are changing. The great experiment to see if souls could incarnate in a world of duality and hardship and still find their way back to the source is a success. And the reward is the evolution of human beings to a higher energy, a higher level of existence, one that has never been achieved before by humankind or the planet Earth. And because the planet will evolve at the same time, this is a sensation for the universe and something that everyone involved should be proud of. This evolution will see the Earth's inhabitants taking their place among the rest of the universe as a galactically awake and contributing race of entities instead of a race of people with amnesia who are struggling to break free of third dimensional energy and karmic ties. So, fellow lightworkers, be proud of yourselves. Give yourselves a hand. Yes, our hard work is paying off. And Gilbert and Aknanda and Jeremy, they ask that we remember, please remember just how powerful we are and that we use our power in the most positive way possible to help ourselves, the human race, and our planet evolve. One vibration at a time. Thank you.